I'm here this morning to come with you with the word of the Lord this morning.
Yes.
If you would turn in your Bibles with me to Isaiah 65. Isaiah the 65th chapter, yes. You know, I was using the New King James Version, but I tell you, I had to resort back to the King James.
Amen.
The New King just,
Amen.
You know, I got to go with the King James, you know.
Stay with it.
Yeah, stay with it. So,
yes.
In the King James Version, Isaiah 65, verse 8, and it reads, "Thus saith the Lord, as the new wine is found in the cluster, and one saith, destroy it not, for a blessing is in it, so will I do for my servant's sake,
yes,
that I may not destroy them all.
Yes.
I will bring forth a seed out of Jacob and out of Judah, an inheritor of my mountains, and mine elect shall inherit it, and my servants shall dwell there.
Yes.
And Sharon shall be a fold of flocks, and the valley of Achor a place for herds to lie down in, for my people that have sought me."
Yes.
He said, "For thy people, for my people that have sought me, that have been seeking his face, that have been looking for him."
Yes.
He said, "Thus saith the Lord, thus saith the Lord, as the new wine is found in the cluster." That means that just because there's a bunch of grapes, there's some good ones in there.
Yes, it is.
He said, "Destroy it not, for a blessing is in it. So will I do for my servant's sake, that I might not destroy them all." Don't you hear that? God will destroy those who don't love him.
Right.
We better pay attention here.
Teach.
He said, "I will bring forth a seed out of Jacob and out of Judah, an inheritor of my mountains, and mine elect shall inherit it, and my servants shall dwell there." Ah, I just want to dwell in the presence of the Lord. I just want to dwell in his peace. You know, he said, "And Sharon shall be like a fold of flocks, and the valley of Achor a place for my herds to lie down in, and my people that have for my people that have sought me."
Come on.
And I was looking for the theme this morning. I was looking for the title. And the Lord told me, he said, "I am is calling for my people."
Come on, man.
Who would you pay that? The "I am" is calling for his people.
That's right.
He's calling them forth out from among them. And I say, church, we have to get serious about the things of God.
That's right.
We got to be serious about the things of the Lord. This is 2018, and I told you this year that the three things the Lord was asking of us. He's asking us to quit acting like the world. We should be in preparation to receive from the Lord. How are we in preparation? We're returning to his house, and it only takes a few months of consistency and with your heart fixed toward him, and he will begin to bless. And I also told you we need to pray harder. We need to pray harder. Why do we need to pray harder? Because he said in his word, "So will I do for my servant's sakes, that I may not destroy them all." Why do we need to pray harder? So he won't destroy us all.
Come on now.
The church is in trouble. The church is in trouble. We're doing things and we're not paying attention to what is going on. And I have to tell you that God is paying attention, and we need to be paying attention in this hour to what is really happening.
Come on now.
You say, what is happening in this hour? What is going forth? Okay, go with me to John, the 4th chapter. It says there in the 23rd verse, "The hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him."
Come on now.
God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. I keep telling y'all, well, you want to say that's the Old Testament. We don't want to do the law. I'm sorry. Jesus told you he did not come to take away the law, but to fulfill it. And in Romans 8, it tells us the law will be fulfilled in us who walk after the Spirit. We got to walk after the Spirit of God. You walk after the Spirit of God, you can fulfill the law. But if you walk according to the flesh, you won't do it.
That's right.
The hour is here. The hour is here, and God is seeking those that worship him. Psalms 24, it tells us this in verse 3. Who shall ascend into the hill of the Lord? Or who shall stand in his holy place? He that hath clean hands. How do you get clean hands? Huh? You didn't get them dirty. Or if you got them dirty, you went and washed. You washed them in the blood.
Amen.
You went and washed yourself. He cleanses us from all unrighteousness. Yeah, excuse me. He cleanses us from all unrighteousness. And what he's doing is, he said, who can ascend? Who can stand in the holy place? He said, he that hath clean hands and a pure heart.
Yes.
Who have not lifted up his soul unto vanity, nor sworn deceitfully. Let me stop right there to that vanity. Amen.
Come on.
Who have not lifted up their soul to vanity and sworn deceitfully. I want you to go with me to Psalms number 4. Psalms, the 4th chapter. I was there this morning. I said, it just jumped off the page at me. I need you to see this. Psalms number 4. Psalms 4, it tells us about that vanity thing. He said, hear me when I call, O God, my righteousness, for thou hast enlarged me when I was in distress. Have mercy upon me and hear my prayer. In verse 2, he says, O ye sons of men, how long will you turn my glory into shame?
Come on now.
How long will you love vanity and seek after leasing? We in the church, we love vanity. We got to get away from this vanity thing and get back to seeking God. It's not about who got the best heels on and the best dress on and the finest suit. It's about who is going to fall down on their face and worship him.
Yeah. Come on now.
Oh, I can't get down there today, my suit is out. I'm telling you, there is no day I can't fall down on my face before my God.
Amen.
There's nothing I have on that I can't fall down before him. Yeah. Amen. This is his vanity. Oh, I can't do it. My hair. No, his vanity. He says, how long will you put my vanity to shame? He said, for Psalms 24, who hath clean hands and a pure heart, have not lifted up his soul unto vanity, nor sworn deceitfully. He shall receive the blessing from the Lord, and the righteousness from God, the God of his salvation.
Come on.
This is the generation that seek, of them that seek him, that seek thy face, O Jacob. Where is that generation? It's time for them to arise. They are stuck in that cluster. They're in that cluster and he wants to bring them out, and they're called Zion.
Amen.
They're called Zion. Oh, church, we got some problems going on here. We don't want to admit it, but in Isaiah 65, he says it all. He says, I am sought of them that ask not for me. I am found of them that sought me not.
Yes.
I said, behold me unto a nation that was not called by my name.
Come on now.
Uh-oh. Let me back. Can I get real? Can I keep it real?
Come on now. Come on. Teach the word.
You have the heathen generation.
Yes.
The descendants of heathen calling out to God more than you do.
That's right. That's right.
He got you. Wait a minute. Whoa. Wait. Yes, those that enslaved us, the descendants, are crying out to God more than his children are.
That's right.
You don't want the truth to come, but I got to bring it to you.
Come on,
because see, we didn't got out here, we didn't got free. He didn't place us in a land where the land flows with milk and honey.
Yes.
Everybody's in this nation is trying, and the world is trying to get here, but God has placed us here. We have opportunity. name. But what do we want to do? We want to rob one another. Yeah. We want to steal from one another. We want to just sit back and drink and get high and do our own thing and think somebody God's supposed to do it for us.
Yes. Yes. My Lord. Teach it.
God, and he's not slothful. And we wonder what is going on. He said, I've spread my hands all the day unto a rebellious people, which walketh in a way that was not good after their own thoughts. A people that provoke me to anger continually to my face, that sacrifices in gardens and burneth incense upon the altars of brick. You might not be burning incense on altars. You may not be sacrificing in the garden, but your heart, it don't belong to God. It don't belong to him.
Come on, Jesus.
Which remain among the graves and lodge in monuments, which eat swine's flesh and the broth of abominable things in their vessels, which say, stand by thyself, come not near to me, for I am holier than thou. Yes. These are smoke in my nose and fire that burneth all day. These are the people that say, well, I'm spiritual. Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'm not religious, I'm spiritual.
Ain't that something?
You're like smoke in his nostrils. Behold, it is written before me, I will not keep silence, but I will recompense into their bosom your iniquities and the iniquities of your fathers.
Come on.
He gonna combine them together. We're sitting up here, we're sleeping on the truth of the matter is that the fact is we know that there is a living God.
Yes.
We know that we have been through some trials and tribulations. Yes. And we know that God has brought us out of them all. But now that you are out, now that you are free, why ain't you on the bended knees of your grandmothers and great-grandfathers who called to a mighty God for our freedom? Yes. We called out and God set us free. 400 years later, here we are and we're still living in bondage of our minds.
Teach the word.
We have to learn. He said that your iniquities and the iniquities of your fathers together, saith the Lord, which have burned incense upon the mountains and blasphemed me upon the hills. Therefore will I measure their former work into their bosom. God is going to recompense unto you what you deserve, what your forefathers have served, told, and now it's being sold by you. Your iniquities, God is calling us out from among them. So who is that generation that seek him? Who can lift up holy hands? Who is going to live holy? Because God said, be ye holy, for I am holy.
That's right.
We're in church today. And we're in these mega churches. And I mean, don't get me wrong, I ain't got nothing against the mega church. Crowd, go. If you get delivered, be there. But what I am saying, if you have to look out, there's too many people in there grocery shopping. Girl, look at him. Hey, is that my Boaz? You ain't come to see God. You looking for Boaz. You looking. Men is up in there. They're not looking for God.
Right.
They looking for who looking at them. You got to seek God with your whole heart. And then still you're still up in there. You're up in them places and you find a guy that breaks your heart and she breaks your heart or whatever. But there, I'm going to deal with the one thing that's really, really got a problem in church. Your iniquities. God has been calling us out. He's been calling the church to come lay down our iniquities on the altar. What are they? They are the past hurts, the sin, the unforgiveness. And so I'm going to stop right there because we need to deal with the biggest one of all, which is unforgiveness.
Amen.
Yeah.
Amen.
Yeah.
The name of this church is Kingdom Application Ministry. So let me teach you how to apply the word in this area.
Come on now.
The whole thing, the whole reason we exist is so that we can teach you how to apply the word and receive some tangible results. And the tangible result today is going to become the fact that you are getting closer to your Father.
Yes, yes.
Unforgiveness. Matthew 6:14 says this, for if you forgive men their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you.
Yes.
But if you forgive not men their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses.
Come on now.
Now, I know unforgiveness is one of the biggest things that's plaguing the church today. The Father sent his Son Jesus, and his main mission was to heal the brokenhearted. Most unforgiveness is rooted in brokenheartedness. Am I correct?
Amen.
Let's deal with it.
Come on.
If it's because of brokenheartedness, we have the most church people that give lip service to the forgiveness part. It comes to forgiveness, we're not realizing that God sees your heart. Even though you're saying, I forgive him with my mouth, with your heart, you have not done so. Yes, I forgave him and I forgave her, but yet you get to court and the truth comes out.
Amen. Amen.
Jesus said, you will know my disciples by the love that you have for one another. Love your neighbor as yourself. So why are we acting like the world? Unforgiveness. And you see, we when I say quit acting like the world, I didn't mean just in the church on Sunday morning. I meant all Monday, Tuesday, Wednesday, Thursday, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday morning again. We got to quit acting like the world when we leave the church. That's your biggest witness. So just saying I forgive him or saying I forgive her is not working. Forgiveness takes work.
Yes, it does.
All right? Forgiveness starts with empathy.
Yes.
Empathy. The ability to understand and share the feelings of another.
Come on now.
So what I have to do is I got to take off my shoes and step into the shoes of this other person that just hurt me and try to figure out why did they hurt me.
Come on now.
So you have to realize that hurt people hurt people.
That's right.
But if they hurt you, in order for you to forgive them, since you just can't do it genuinely, look, I want you to apply some empathy and look at the history of that person's life.
Come on now.
You have to learn as much as you can about the person that harmed you to see what their experiences have been.
Right.
See, the reason God can forgive you is, see, God sits here. He sits here. He's outside of time. You are walking this path along life, and you interrupt somebody right here and hurt them, but you keep going, God can forgive you. See, but God saw where you came from. I met you right here. I didn't see where you came from. So I have to ask the question. I have to go back and figure out, oh, your mom used to beat you. Oh, your dad left you. Oh, you've been rejected all your life. Oh, you've been in prison and this happened to you. See, once I figure out the pain of your life, now I can understand your problem and I can empathize with you and say, man, I forgive you because of the things that you... See, God knows what you've been through. I didn't know, but now that I have found out, man, let me give you a hug. Brother, let me embrace you. You see, I have to understand some. See, I'm not talking about nobody else. I'm talking about Lorenzo. See, I had to forgive my father. You have to understand something. See, my father, and I was rejected by my father when I was in high school, and I couldn't understand. And my mom and him, they had a divorce. I knew it wasn't, I wasn't the fault of it, but when they got divorced, he moved out. So I decided I'm going to live with him. I'm 16 years old. I'm going to move in with him. But what I didn't realize is that when I got there, a week later, he called my mom, and she came and picked me up. My brother said, pack your stuff, let's go. I was like, no, I live here. I'm not going. I live with my father. But my brother said, your father is who called us to come get you. So I packed my things and I left. I was 16 years old. I did not figure it out until I was almost 45, 42 years old what happened. And I begin to dig into the history of my father's life. See, my father, his mom cheated on his dad, so his dad divorced his mom and went to Chicago. My dad, being 15, moved to Chicago. go after turning 15 because the stepdad, he was bigger than the stepdad, and so he looked like his father, so he became a threat to the household, so he had to get out.
My Lord.
So he put him out and he went to live with his father at 15, 16 years old. But when he got to live with his father at 16 years old, his father put him out at 16. He had to work and stand on his own from that point on. So I asked that figure, why did he put him out? He put him out because my grandfather's wife, his new wife, wasn't but a few years older than my father.
My Lord.
So I look back on my own life and I realize that my father put me out because guess what?
Come on.
I wasn't but a few years younger than his wife.
Yes.
See, after you understand the history, then you're able to forgive. Now I can forgive my father because he only did what he was taught. Mm-hmm. See, now you see a lot of people are hating their parents. I'm gonna stop right here. Well, a lot of people are in church and they despise their own flesh and blood, but you've got to thank God that you're here.
Come on.
Woo! And really, it's not about what they did and how they grew up and what they went through. That ain't got nothing to do with you. God gave you an opportunity to praise his holy name.
Yes.
He gave you an opportunity to serve him. He gave you an opportunity to exercise some empathy for your family.
Yes.
Woo! You better work on him again.
Yes.
See, what you don't understand is that God understands what that person been through. God understands what you've been through. He only asks that you, by faith, forgive them. Hallelujah. If you can do it by faith, just do it by, just trust the Lord. Lord say forgive and he'll forgive you. So guess what? I'm not going to hold them accountable for the sin against me. I'm just going to say, guess what? Lord, I forgive them.
Amen.
Help me forgive them in my heart. I trust you, God. You said forgive, so I'm going to forgive.
Yeah.
Hurt people. Uh-huh. It's just like the guy up in the football camp, up in Penn State, the coach that did all that to them young men, and everybody was coming against him. He shouldn't have did this. Sandusky, what's his name? Something like that. But then everybody was coming against him, and I was like, no. What happened to him when he was a young man?
Yes.
And it's the same thing. That don't excuse what he done, but only thing he done was a learned behavior.
Learned, that's it.
It's a learned behavior.
That's right.
No, it don't excuse. Yes, he need to go to jail. He should have got delivered. Mm-hmm. Amen.
Right.
This forgiveness thing is so serious. See, you have to understand, sir. And so let me say one for the fellas and the ladies who out there tripping in church that out there picking up men. Let me tell you something. If you can't forgive them, let me tell you something. The only reason you're hurt is because you violated one of God's laws. God told me, man, I was so upset one time, and the Lord told me, forgive them. I said, okay, Lord, I'm going to forgive them. And I had to forgive them. Because God told me, he said, you know what? If you hadn't have violated my law, they wouldn't have been able to trespass against you. If you hadn't violated the law of God, then that wouldn't have opened you up and made you susceptible for them to trespass against you.
Yes.
So forgive them. Amen. I hope I'm helping you here. I hope I'm helping you get free this morning. See, this forgiveness thing is so serious. It even hinders the harvest of your blessing.
That's right.
In Matthew 5, it tells us, therefore, if thou bring thy gift to the altar, and there remembers that thy brother have an ought against thee, leave it there. Leave there thy gift before the altar. Go thy way, first be reconciled to thy brother, and then come back and give thy gift. You have to understand, this forgiveness thing is what got a whole lot of the church going to hell. Because if God don't forgive you of your sin, I'm sure your trespass was sinful. Amen. He said, thus saith the Lord. I'm back over in Isaiah 65. As new wine is found in the cluster, will you be that new wine today? And one saith the Lord, destroy it not, for a blessing is in it. Will you be that blessing? So will I do for my servant's sake that I may not destroy them all. I will bring forth a seed out of Jacob and out of Judah, inheritor of my mountain. God wants us to forgive our brothers and sisters. God wants us to leave it all on the altar.
Yes.
God wants us to do the work and exercise some empathy in the lives of his people so he can bless you.
Yes, amen.
Amen.
Gracious. Oh, he's a good God.
Yes, he is. Amen.
Ah, my goodness. He said, and Sharon shall be a fold of flocks, and the valley of Achor a place for the herds to lie down in, for my people that have sought me. Are you truly seeking God?
Come on now.
Let me tell you about the Valley of Achor.
Come on.
The Valley of Achor is where Achan and his family were stoned to death for taking that bounty out of Jericho.
That's right.
When he told them there shouldn't be nothing taken out of Jericho, Achan and his family took some stuff. They took some gold, some silver, and they hid it in the tent. And when they went to fight against Ai, children of Israel lost that battle.
Yes.
And they came to the Lord crying out. And the Lord said, get up, wipe your face. What are you crying to me for? Somebody has sinned in the camp.
Mm-hmm.
And Joshua went tent to tent by tent by tent. And when he found Achan, them had done it.
Right.
It cost Achan and his whole family their lives.
Yes, it did.
That valley right now is still there today.
Mm-hmm.
And it's a term. He said Achan, he's a term. The Valley of Achor is a term used prophetically to indicate the Lord will bring about a blessing in your future in the places that caused you trouble, and it was caused by their sin. Think about that. You see, slavery today, when he said, I will bring you out of Egypt, today's Egypt was right here in the U.S.
That's right.
He didn't brought us out.
That's right.
He didn't brought us out, but we don't, like we deserve. Man, come on.
That's right, brother.
It's time to worship him.
Yes.
Time to serve him.
Yes.
Freely, openly. And look, I ain't got nothing against them. God used them to do what he needed to do to get us back on track.
That's right.
Amen.
Amen.
I ain't got nothing. I love everybody. We all got red blood. That I love. Look, don't get me wrong. We can worship together. I want Zion looks like that. And I'm telling you, my brothers and sisters that are out there robbing, stealing, getting high, smoking, and drinking your life away, you're going to come to judgment day and talk about, I love God and he loved me. Yeah, God, I'm going to tell you yes. And you had several opportunities to come to me, but yet still you chose the thing of the world over me.
Teach me.
He's not, look, you got too many opportunities to come to God.
That's right.
Verse 16, skip down there with me. Oh, let me deal with Sharon first. Sharon, or Ha-Sharon, is the plain or a level place. And its largest coastal plains of North Palestine from the Crocodile River to the north to the Valley of Ajalon and Joppa in the south. A distance of about 50 miles. It has a bearable width from 9 to 10 miles wide. This place is a plain, flat land. It says the excellency of Sharon is like the pride of Jordan. It's dense vegetation originally associated with the whole plain. Rich soil not utilized extensively under irrigation, groves, and other commercial farming formerly yielded beautiful covers of wildflowers. And what was his name? They called him Jesus. He was the Rose of Sharon. Amen.
Right morning star.
It's a person's eternal state of peace forevermore.
Amen.
That's got to be beautiful.
Amen.
Amen. Verse 16, it tells us that he who blesses himself in the earth shall bless himself in the God of truth.
Amen.
Let me stop right there. If you want to be a blessing of yourself, you want to bless yourself, you better pick up the word.
Come on.
You can't bless yourself with stuff.
Come on.
I ain't got nothing but Bible. And he said, he that sweareth in the earth shall swear by the God of truth. If you don't say something is true, you better go back to the word and show him where it's found. Because the former troubles are forgotten, and because they are hid from mine eyes. Amen. Amen. For behold, I create new heavens and a new earth, and the former shall not be remembered nor come into mind. See, you have to understand something. God is calling his people to worship. God is calling his people to come out from among them. He's calling them to come out from among them. He's calling out Zion.
Come on now.
He's calling. See, come you on. Have to understand something. God has always been for all mankind. He said, all that choose to dwell in among you, you let them sanctify themselves. Yes. Let them cleanse themselves from all unrighteousness. Let them get rid of the old nature and put on the nature of Christ.
Yes.
If they can put on the nature of Christ, they belong to him.
Come on.
And I can say this and say it well. Don't let your life be messed up here on earth, and then you give it away and go to hell the same way.
Yeah.
Are you kidding me?
Come on.
God has been too good to us. He chose us out of all the generations to be here this day.
That's right. Come on.
Amen.
To serve him.
Amen.
We serve him and worship him. Serve him in truth.
Mm-hmm.
Worship him in truth.
Amen.
Ecclesiastes 12. Solomon said it best. He said, let us hear the conclusion of the whole matter.
Whole matter.
The conclusion. Fear God, keep his commandments.
That's right.
For this is the whole duty of man.
Yes.
That's our job.
Yes.
That's our whole job. No matter what you do, fear him and keep his commandments.
Yes.
For God shall bring every work into judgment and every secret thing, whether it be good or whether it be evil. God is not playing today.
Come on now.
He ain't playing. He is judging the earth.
That's right.
And he's telling us, even in scripture, come out from among them.
That's right.
Come out. He said, I'm not going to destroy the cluster because it's some new wine in the bunch.
Come on.
Just because it's a bunch, just because your whole family is acting crazy, don't mean you got to be one of them too.
That's right.
Amen.
That's right.
Come on out and love God.
Amen.
Come on out and serve him. Come on out and just enjoy the goodness of the Lord. It said, oh, come taste and see of his goodness.
Yes.
Taste the Lord. Try him.
Yes.
And see, won't you know that he is good?
Yes.
Amen.
Yes.
Amen. Shall we stand?
Amen.
Amen. I want you to understand something. God is so good to us. He has thought of us in so many ways. He has blessed us. He has kept us. And the least you can do is bless him.
Yes, ma'am. Yes, sir.
He says, life is but a vapor.
Yes, yes.
Have you seen when you blow your breath on the window and it goes away? That's your life.
Come on.
That's your life compared to eternity.
Yes.
So you're going to spend that vapor going to hell when you can spend it concentrating on eternity with him?
Yes. Thank you, Jesus.
That's a lot of time, man.
Yes.
Heard a guy say it's like one of the little brown birds grabbing a grain of sand and flying it all the way to the moon and coming back and getting every grain of sand off of every beach, off of every desert in this world.
Mm.
And when he's done, eternity will be just begun. I can't spend that much time in hell.
Yeah.
I'm sorry. He made me to worship him. He made me to praise his holy name.
Hallelujah.